pleasure to introduce Fred Esch. Fred is the principal of Esch Environmental Design at Charlottesville, Virginia. He has been doing environmental design for over 35 years. Fred customizes with architecture, custom interiors, furniture, and fine art. And I can't wait to hear what he has to tell us about everything that he's done. If you want to know more about Fred, hopefully you all have a chance to meet him. But you can follow him on fredesch.com. Without further ado, thank you, Fred.
Can you
speak? Oh, yes.
Today, much appreciated. Thanks to Donna for inviting me. I feel very honored to be here and to you also this amazing building, which is a prime example of exactly what we're talking about today. And some of the learning objectives, I guess, that we're trying to accomplish today is maybe more an understanding about that interconnectedness that we all strive for between the built environment and that interrelationship and that unity, if you will. Also, some approaches, some strategies, some ideas on how we can start to be more resilient and responding to climate change. A part of that, I think, is the role that intentional communities or eco-village communities can have in that process. And then opportunities that we have, I think, in looking toward the future on how we can continue with this notion of sustainability and redesigning. So this story really starts and moves with our planet, where we are. This is really, we are a part of it, not reside on it, but everything is interrelated and integral to the planet that we are on. This little isolated group all is out in the cosmos, and so our interrelationship with the planet and vice versa is going to be paramount in our ongoing sustenance and thriving. So there's a few little terms I'll be introducing to you if you're not already familiar with as we go along. One is Gaia hypothesis, a Gaia theory, developed by James Lovelock back in the 70s. The basic idea is that the planet Earth really is functioning very much like a single cell, like a single living interconnected organism. And so that's really paramount not only to the science behind it all, but also the spiritual side of perceiving our planet and our relationship. So part of what makes a living organism such is the qualities that it has in terms of being self-regulating, self-renewing, self-maintaining, sustaining as a living organism does. And when you start thinking about what's happening globally with our environment, what we call climate change, global warming, whatever term you want to put for it, I think it's self-evident that change is happening. And it's happening at a more increasingly rapid rate and becoming more and more extreme. So as designers, as architects, as engineers, it's really our responsibility to figure out what can we do in response to that, not only in terms of slowing down the process, remaking the process, changing it, but also adapting, all of those things all at once. I think just my own personal take on it is, it really is requiring kind of a change in consciousness when it comes to energy, because so much of the way at least our financial world operates is based on some of the more negative human qualities, I would say, in terms of community members, profit, financial profit only for the sake of profitability, without really taking into account, how does this paradigm really affect just the quality of life and living on our world today? So I think, in terms of responding response to this, I think it really begins at kind of a very fundamental, personal, even spiritual level as we move forward. And of course, then there's more technical aspects of the infrastructure, of course, passive engineering, and just making the process. One of the things that I've discovered, kind of self-evident, all of the harm that we are causing to the environment, a lot of times, you just kind of leave nature alone to give it the opportunity to regenerate itself. So I think there's some wisdom in that approach in some instances to begin with. And again, this sort of spiritual connection, this notion of ecology versus what we might call deep ecology, where it's not ego-driven, it's more thinking in terms of the interrelationship that we all have with all of the life on the planet, and in long-term effects rather than short-term gain at the expense of our future, for example. So this notion of deep ecology, I think, is really, again, part of the spiritual foundation that is going to help us to get from where we are to where we actually want to be. And so, we're not just living on this planet, we are a part of an interrelationship with all of life that is in this planet. And then this notion of symbiosis, or a symbiotic relationship with nature. There's different types of symbiosis, some where two different platforms or species really apparently side by side, but really have very little effect one upon the other necessarily. There's a parasitic relationship, which I would say that to some extent in some places we as human beings have become parasitic on our planet, our relationship. And then there's the mutualistic relationship where both can benefit. And that's what we need to be looking for and establishing. You hear so much about, to me, it's kind of buzzword sustainability. What does that really mean? And just the basics of the word, to sustain. I'm not really sure that, by my notion, that's really what we're after. I mean, if we need to go beyond sustaining what we have, and we can think more in terms of regenerative systems or healing type systems that we want there. So I like to use a little imaginary of growing crops, where I think this notion of sustainability really kind of puts the cart before the horse in some sense, that really what needs to happen is we start by conserving what we already have, so you don't need to produce what we're not consuming. And recycling as much as we can, but we then using new resources and materials, optimizing the systems that we have, and then producing the power and materials and buildings, and then once we kind of come to those preliminary steps, then sustaining that and moving that to a living regenerative systems. So some principles, at least I think some of them, of what is regenerative design, environmental design. The idea that design is really kind of a way of life. It's not an afterthought. It's not an add-on. It really is integral with how we're living their lives day to day. And reflecting local, regional traditions, materials, labor skills, indigenous to that area, whether it's imported materials, long distances, kind of using what's there and available to you applications. Response to microclimate. We're 5 miles from here, it's different than the climate is here, particularly in an area of foothills, mountains. Sometimes the microclimates are very, very localized. So you really for something, he wants to see what's happening right beside him, which would be the building impacted in some way. Minimum inventory diversity systems, I'm going to be talking more about that, but the notion that a kit of parts, we really try to simplify the component pieces of parts of some systems, buildings that you might want to use, but then you can integrate it into virtual or unintuitive ways. I think it's really the natural systems nature. Nature itself is just that. It is, in fact, the environment for our maximum energy system. So often, there's a disconnect between the designer and who's ultimately going to end up occupying the buildings. So I think trying to work toward more of a direct connection between designer and engineer and interaction, especially commercial buildings or institutional buildings, I think have that flaw where not so much residential, but larger projects where there's just that disconnect. There's that disconnection between the ultimate habitat of the space and the design of the front. So trying to strengthen that connection. And then ultimately, we talked about zero, but to me, ultimately, that we just don't need to get on that. So we're actually producing more energy than what we are consuming as an objective. And then self-regulating living systems, and we'll be talking about more of what I can constitute living systems, living architecture of the buildings. So getting to the subject of today, biophilia, or hypothesis or biophilic design, that really is always kind of one of the core practices. Wilson, who proposed that there is an inherent characteristic of human nature to see and to want and feel comfortable with that connection between pestilence and the environment and nature. So approaching it that way can strengthen the strength of that individual. And also another very famous four-liner book by biophilic design was published something more involved in a book on this subject. So it's just very instrumental in starting this tool in this book. Of course, we have sort of subcategories of how that can happen with direct experience with nature, of course, indirect. And then just the experience of space and place and time, all of that as well. And it's broad, really. There's no features, there's no data more in terms of design, style, if you will, by the memory, using natural processes and mimic. Not only visually, but also how natural systems themselves adapt and evolve and approaching that, adapting that to the design process itself. Similar things, there's light, air, circulation, spaces, as we see right in this time of where we are. And that interconnectedness just pulls it all together. And one of the things that I think is processes, the biophilic design process itself is non-linear. So often, some designers sort of on to all of that data in the district at one time. But then, beyond that, it evolves, and it grows. So there may be several iterations of that sort of spiraling sort of design process over time, but again, it's not common. And what are the sort of direct, maybe more obvious benefits of bi-village design? Certainly, I think really good examples of, again, where we are right at the moment, this kind of environment is very conducive to learning, to holding attention, to just good in the space. Certainly, as work, make a difference in terms of his productivity, less absenteeism from work, forward going to this place where you're going to be working, rather than kind of avoiding it. Environments of connection make you sick because of whatever pains, carpets, whatever is off-gassing, whatever is moving, or the air environment, or the natural light coming in, and kind of goes on and on about. So certainly within the workplace environment, there's a big difference. Just being surrounded by plants, water elements, fresh air, natural lighting. I can speak firsthand about the effect that it makes. This is my own office that I work out of. My office in Schuyler, Virginia, South Australia, so. And I call it my own cubicle because, you know, by the nature of design, I'm super much time on a computer, but it's all glass, floor to ceiling, it's all overlooking the waterway, and it's like anything, well, it is literally being in nature for like all day long, being surrounded by nature, so I find it very inspirational, and it makes me feel like the work that I need to do all the time, without kind of losing my mind in that process. So that's my own home and office. Another good example of where bi-village design really comes in and be so very useful is in like medical facilities, whether like hospitals or certain rehab centers where people are doing their substance abuse, who are really trying to get reconnected with nature. So really very, very useful at those kinds of spaces. Just a simple example like this within a hospital room, that can be done otherwise, which is much more of a human environment, regardless of any treatment that we're undergoing, it's just the environment itself that makes a huge difference. Circadian rhythms, the cycles that all living things go through, basically on a 24-hour cycle, and certainly this applies to things like lighting, where the sun itself is attracts over a 24-hour period. It changes its angle, its intensity, its color shifts. So just taking advantage of that and using circadian lighting that changes color or intensity during different times of the day, and also this as well. So paying attention to those central cycles that have and adapting our technology and our light systems to mimic those natural processes. When we look toward design itself in terms of style and form, nature itself here again is a great strategy for approaching that. You're going to find within nature that some self-similar patterns keep themselves as a node throughout all the natural forms that happen in the world. This is kind of like, I think, kind of a comical example. This time, Luigi Pini, who is kind of renowned industrial designer, but his biomimicry design is pretty literal in some sense. But it's an example of how we can use natural forms that are naturally aerodynamic to design forms of inventory, maximum diversity, like a complex. It implemented very simple, simplistic example is ticker points, where you just have just a few components, and then can be assembled as a virtual complex number of ways. And we'll see that in almost all of the systems throughout nature. Some sort of obvious examples is just like this, or something. Complex, which have the same molecular components, but so as you know, every cell is different, and so there's an infinite kind of variety among those components. Probably the beaker, mostly the triangle, those probably the beaker can be expanded in space to fill space. And for example, that are space frames where it can be all the way from those sort of almost like a flat or planar type geometry to something that's sort of curvilinear and freeform. So, Legos. There are just kind of two pieces and assemble them and kind of right over the middle of the world. And, so I think it's even kind of interesting. Which is live later. So we have a few blocks, we dry stack them without order, and then we just sort of find these in them for the shell type structure. And so you know, it makes sense on a small scale, and makes sense on a larger scale as well. And a part of that minimum environmental diversity is really what we're talking about is fractal. Fractal design, fractal ordering, and resonance patterning. So a fractal is really just the same pattern that it would scale all the way from a large to small. And that can apply, let's say, branching, for example, like a tree, or a river system, veins in the body, on the bottom. You see that in architecture, you see it, it's sort of inherently beautiful. It's here in the temple. The example, I think, is some art architecture, or any kinds of violence, or the same thing anywhere. These have very basic little cubic sort of simplistic forms, and backbones, or arches, spherical shapes, but yet just incredible variety of incredible basic components that we put together. Or the habitat of the Montreal, but it's like the Legos, only kind of houses or other means, and just on the other assembled, has the same qualities, just very similar to walk through it, much like it seems to be. Experience of walking through those spaces and around those courtyards is essentially the same. Same basic. You see that in Frank Lloyd Wright's work, not only his architecture, but you see it all the way into his furniture and his stained glass, all the way down to his sculptures. So you certainly see that in his work as well. I think one of the more interesting these repetitive patterns, the resonant patterns, is certainly the spiral, the rhythmic spiral, or the smallest spiral. And again, you see it everywhere, all the way from the FF brain to the galaxies to the hurricane, the sound of the one, and everywhere in between. So that's one of the more beautiful patterns you see everywhere. And so this actually is an interesting project. We're using that, and I'm probably going to see this too often, the spiral shapes like that in architecture, when a lot of times you have some budget constraints or whatever. But this particular project, the kind of case study I want to mention, is it's located just west of Charlottesville, originally designed in the 70s by James Cooley, who was a local MR in Charlottesville. And I had the honor of residents and expanding the bubble and flipping the size into a more spiritual retreat center. And so, you know, it raises the question, how do you add on to, you know, the spiral that, how do you add on to a work of art like this, like every other edition of the Frank Lloyd Wright building, maintaining the integrity of it, that strong value on the same process. So the top here is some purities, original bronze. And then what we're looking at right now, as you see, it's just kind of expanded the space. The space is really what I would call a natural outgrowth of the geometry and the shapes of the sort of quality there itself. Not unlike actually living on this room in the additional chamber and expanding itself that way. So here again, the original up here. This is the first level, and now I think we're looking at expanding more of the third tier. We're getting it really more of a base than what we had before, it's a little bit complicated, but I think an example of responding to what's there is sort of natural outgrowth and expansion. So again, responding to climate change, what are our opportunities as we move forward in applying climate design to that process? If you're not familiar with the little advertisement, if you're not familiar with zones for change, I highly recommend that you do so. It's kind of an evolution of what used to be the Virginia Sustainable Building Network, which was headed up by MFSO, which you might have seen in the Michael. It's a very wonderful new organization that's kind of moved into kind of just what it says. You know, what are the means by which we can build more resilient, adaptive buildings as we move forward? So, again, if you're not familiar with that organization, I encourage you to do that. And symbiotic solutions. I think that case by case, you can look to indigenous materials, systems, labor skills, where you find yourself, what's available to you in that location. Certainly worldwide, a lot of years is being made just the earth itself, whether that be adobe, or rambler, or palm, or rhododendron, or any number of just basic just earthen materials, such as straw bale, which is locally available. Easily renewable resource. So using just indigenous materials and labor skills is a good place to start. I'm also looking for passive systems, heating, cooling, humidification. Too much these days, I think we rely ourselves upon mechanical systems to work for us. One example that we see a lot of debate perhaps is passive valves. Some community with that, to me personally, I think that in the right location, in the right region, that it can be good. I think that in other regions, it can perhaps be overkill, but the biggest critique that I would have of it is that you could have a certified passive house with no solar, no natural daylighting, and just the whole thing functions off of mechanical systems. So that's where, to me, there can be well-intended paradigms or ways of thinking through things that can be spread. So you, as much passive systems as we can do, I think, especially consuming energy, of course, especially in some of the regions in the United States where we don't have, we have a shortage of fresh water, is rainwater capture and recycling and rainwater systems. There's home movement. A lot of folks are doing kind of do-it-yourself, using natural, indigenous materials, developing their skills. You can do some very beautiful sort of organic buildings, not only in terms of stylistically, but also using different materials. The tiny house movement, and one of the most important things with that as well is that you're downsizing to an absolute house, and so they can stylistically can pretty much look like whatever you might want them to, but for a lot of folks, you know, all the way from empty nesters to first home buyers to college students, you know, there's a very, very broad demographic that especially if you're kind of in the eco aspects of it, to where, you know, parking, which, you know, somehow, you know, I'm just thinking, we could destroy a site, we could have the roads injured, we could be parking. A lot of the housing models, certain village models, many of them have concentrated parking in the spot, the location, and then we walk to residents, and we take a little, like, kind of golf cart, or whatever it is, to the residents. So the site plan, I think, is really important to start for regardless of the recreation buildings and investment facilities, and what about, so, and really close to the community. And then, you know, whether it's just a national community or a Eco Village, and shared resources, like garden spaces, and special places like fire pit, recreational area, play areas, certain educational facilities that we're able to get at on a larger scale. So the idea of really having those community events and amenities available to everyone. One of the other keys, I think, is particularly with living sort of close to get communities like that, is trying to find that balance between opportunity for the community at large to come together as needed, as wanted, whether that be in dining or whatever it might be. But then at the same time, to have private spaces available too. So you can kind of, as you might choose, sort of be alone, be away, be private, have that available to you both as you might choose in the next environment. And that's what some of the different parts of that. Again, this is a part of the community, which I think is one of the better examples that I know of, but really very successful. Where their cottage industry that really supports the whole community as organic seeds, which they raise a lot of money themselves, so no GM home stuff, I can go back, they can put on set up, and grow a lot, there's also a lot, they ship all over the United States, so their cottage industry that supports them. And then this is another project that I'm currently working on in Charlottesville. The one I just showed you was in rural, where they have a pretty tiny acreage, something like that. In this case, it's 4.6 acres, and it's just outside of the city of Charlottesville. And we're looking to accomplish sort of those same things that I already talked about, trying to, you know, it's under 6 acres, trying to preserve as much of the growth, the wild trees, the already on the site, set aside, put a sanctuary as a place that's open and touching and grown. But at the same time, looking at clustering the buildings, building groupings where we can, that actually facilitates community interaction. You know, as you're walking on the way to the mailbox, you pass by the neighbor's porch, and you stop and put a chat, and so there's that ability to interact, and just kind of creates that opportunity to just convey their life. But then as this preliminary design shows here, also each one of these little units that are clustered together has, each one has a elevated rooftop type space that you can kind of use for whatever you want, but it's a private space, so you can kind of be up and above if you want, your own private, secure space. You can do gardening if you want, or sex space, whatever you choose. It gives you that balance that I was just describing between opportunity for communal interaction and also private space as well. And in this particular project, this is an example of trying to integrate the idea of this community awareness and diversity idea. So, you know, it starts out real simple. There's 20 by 40 box, basically. So this box is 800 square feet. So this one area could be a small 800 square foot unit. That's all. If you start to stack these, then you can have your second, or you can have your third floor if you want. And just very neither case, these units can be abutted side by side, which enables us to be facing south, so for active solar, or the solar thermal for the water, we can put it in the floor, or the case, allows you to continue through surfaces, if you can accomplish that, make water catchment, also easy to get under the channel. And then depending on the topography, you have to come from this side, or in some cases, you can uphill side. So again, there's just a simple shift in the roof geometry, whether or not there's a little addition module or a greenhouse module. You can kind of choose which ones of those components you might want, depending upon the desires of the sector of the site, and just a simple set of options. You can have all of those variables. So that's part of what we're looking for there. And so it all really kind of comes down to thinking in terms of the five elements, really, you know, earth, air, fire, water, and spirit. And so when you take the earth part of it, if you're not familiar with the Nature Institute, that's the kind of chapter 2, the Living Building Challenge, where living programs function, like living systems, and as you use living systems as well. And one good example I think that are dedicated use, where there's so many virtues of educated groups, all the way from kind of returning to some extent to Alcatraz, for the birds and bees that the building footprint normally would take away, in the northern areas, for the soundproofing, acoustically, the cool roof, the evaporation configuration, the urban environment, strong rainwater mitigation, some of the black water virtues to the roofs, and they can also easily adapt an existing building in most cases with a system like this, because it's really a fairly type of subject with three origins, and since a light roof, most existing roofs will make that without additional structural buildup. And so it's very capable to upgrade existing buildings. I have several clients who are actually doing rooftop gardening, which myself included, it's my own home, because sunshine is using water, fencing from the year out, so it can be very useful space for that as well, home garden can be very good. Green walls, vertical and vertical garden at all scales, all the way from your own home to more urban environments where you provide food sources, growing over the vertical farm, if you will, or the vertical environment, so you're not transporting those food long distances. You're coming up with kind of a reason to enter the world's food, the atmosphere, and you can integrate these things too on every scale, all the way from the end, your own home to the larger scale where the environments where you can have integrated with aquaculture, growing up with fish, and part of that sort of central pipe system. So there's a lot of benefits, fresh air, by having a vertical wall like this and passing air through it, again, your environment, your own home. Producing oxygen, including that, which can be a very enriching quality as well. So, seeing this earth, let me give you a quick history, if I may, of earth shelter or underground constructions. So, which have been around really for a millennium. This is a specific example right here, actually in Labrador, the construction of the Viking Village in Labrador. But, as you can see, just using the indigenous materials there that was available in that area, they were able to reconstruct which is very, very good, maintenance, upkeep, longevity for some place. Because it is a surface, it is living, it is alive. So it is a type of thing to be done with itself. Jumping ahead to more modern day, Henry Thomas, Malcolm Wells, was kind of the pioneer and trying to get us back into the first chapter of structural leadership and policy and started that process for us. Michael Reynolds, the familiar of these earthships, there's a community out there on Taos in Mexico, and using recycled tires. Some of these there are hundreds of them worldwide, so they've been done in a lot of places. I think this one I actually did myself back in 2000 in Virginia. And it was a very interesting learning experience from that. The notion and idea of using recycling industrial waste product, tires, and tin cans. The notion of that is really strong, really valuable. It turns out that there are a lot of sort of technical issues with trying to actually do that. Some of which is the labor involved in doing it is hard to estimate because each one of those tires requires several hours of very hard getting with a sledgehammer to compact the soil inside those tires. So a lot of labor involved in doing it, and of course there's stuff like that. Thousands of tires who do that, it's a point of stress, had to be done, was reasonable. Some other aspects is that you see here that generally the sort of U shape, which works structurally for the backfall, running it in from a hill, for example, very difficult to waterproof that, because you're going to have a shed of pressure from the water from coming right through that wall. Can be done, obviously. And then probably the biggest one, the biggest challenge is the off-gassing of those tires themselves. How do you effectively seal all of this very lumpy, bumpy surface on the inside to prevent the off-gassing from going properly? So what we call this kind of smart but not wise. I do think that the biggest plus side of this system is actually the building itself in section, because we've got the south-facing glass, we've got thermal mass on the floor, a lot of these have particular shades that you pull up, which are going to kind of be radiation and overheating. Most of them are very hard catchment systems. A lot of them Southwest where they're permitted have gray and black water biologically based wastewater treatment systems. So there's certainly some virtues in this, but in terms of labor, time, I would say in that sense expensive, even if the fires are free. So that's part of the equation. The approach is either just a bump, steel concrete, reinforced steel, tremendous better body energy. In this kind of system, the total amount of energy that goes into the production of the volunteer itself, concrete, supporting it, steel, and supporting that, the labor, sort of on the button, and other so again, very in the words, like a bunker, but very, very costly, not only financially, but in terms of the impact that it has on the environment itself. And then another option is kind of like the work of Swiss architect Peter Detsch, which I think is closer to maybe what we're trying to be heading with this, with the sheltered housing. Here again, we're using steel and concrete. However, it's not cast in place. It's what you see here, you build up with a wire, rebar and wire mesh framework. And then it's more of a thin shell kind of shapes, plastic repair models of the things that the dog is down. But there again, expensive. And that's also assuming that you have someone who has experience and understands how to do this. But what does result in is probably much more shapeable, free-form, perpendicular, independent style. Shapes, patterns, so that kind of brings us up to what I think personally is kind of the best current state of the option, most state of the option that we have. There are a couple of companies out there that are producing it. The one that I really enjoy that I'm working with actually is called Biotech. And it is a minimum inventory, biodiversity system. They are made out of fiber reinforced panels. They're only about an inch thick, so the panels have an inner and outer, in essence, a fiberglass shell with about an inch of high density rigid foam insulation, cap insulation, which they have recycled water bottles. But with this system, you can get apart. You can kind of assemble them in virtually an unlimited number of ways. So you can plan, you can rectilinear, L, U, it can be tiny house, you can make them really quite small, or there's really kind of no upper limit on how large you can actually make them. They conform to virtually topography, all the way from the flat site to the hillside, and then between. Uses a minimal amount of materials when it comes to its total body energy. I think that it works well there. Here you see a kit being delivered, pretty lightweight. In essence, it's like a sailboat hull, and it's basically the same material you're working on here. For your boot suffer, it's really good because simplistic forms, you can pour a slab, put it across things, but normally this is on grade, the panels that sealed and bolted together, sealed and bolted to the slab. It's already waterproof, but typically used in this region, spray foam the entire exterior with maybe 4 inches of rigid foam insulation, which is also waterproof. So you have some built up redundancy in waterproofing, and all the foundation drains, which we have. And then we have a backflow on top of it. And where you have more of the seat grade, you can use a textile fabric or a higher carbon resistant erosion to be established. You can put sentinels and sedums, wildflowers, grasses, parasites, and argue the sound of the structure if you want. So, and they're very affordable. Finished out turnkey. Half the cost of conventional construction in this area. So, of course, bare minimum, but so, possessing maintenance, materials not exposed to sunlight, some heat degradation. So, pretty much, the cost of the materials. So that's earth. Air. Just a few things here that I spoke earlier, these are passive systems, non-mechanical systems. I think these are two sort of good examples of that. This can be the sea building I showed you earlier, but this is in the section. And what's significant here is a couple of things. It has this big roof monitor that goes pretty much from one end to the other, which functions really well in terms of natural ventilation. So kind of like this diagram shows, you can introduce cool air from the north side while the heat rises naturally. You can supplement with simple ceiling fans. It doesn't come from the ducting. Heat rises, exhaust. What happens, you can see the open doors on the windows on the main floor. And up here, as the heat is being expelled in the summer, it creates a negative pressure inside the building, so it pulls in cool air naturally from where we have openings, and it's also tied on the nice big conductive currents going back down and circulating. It's very difficult to do without a meter and a compass and that additional height that gets some conductive currents going. But again, without ducting, without minimal chemicals involved. The other thing that's happening here too is this is the south side here. But there's actually bedroom spaces, residential bedrooms up here on the upper floor. We have all the offices on the main. But over these doors are little transom windows, and the sunlight goes to work out so that in the winter, when the sun is a little bit slower, the sun comes all the way through these monitor windows, through the little transoms above the doors, so you get direct sun coming all the way down, even to those northern open spaces in the winter. Of course, in the summer, overhangs and proportions so that all of that sun glass is in shade and natural in the sun. No living parts, just one part. Fire, of course, solar gives opportunity for all of us in these days becoming increasingly more affordable. Thermal for hot water, the things that you were doing before, which highly recommend. Very efficient, no bulb spots, no grass, heat, and some of them having that block in this case to another. And of course, active solar, which are not grid tied and not on the batteries or not in the current situation. No regulations, just in scaling. Water, that's increasingly a focus worldwide, the shortage of natural fresh water. So there's a lot of opportunities there for very simple rainwater catchment systems in the rain barrel, or having it set up through a scrambling barrier with some kind of well nearby that the rainwater comes out and the well gets in for a minute. It just keeps feeding that. This particular project that IPA has what's called a butterfly roof. So it's intentionally designed where they can shave the water off, the funnel of the water to the center of the location. In this case, it creates a little rain. When there's a rain event, the entrance is back under here, so it creates a little waterfall, which is brought back under the waterfall. And then it feeds into this other part of the home pool, which then actually gravity feeds it over the overflow, so you can bring your irrigated gardens pretty down the hill. So it's a very passive system. And as the oceans are rising, increasingly there are areas where there are whole countries that are actually being lost underwater. If you look at maps of what's happening in Florida or maybe here, for example, in certain areas, it seems that there's going to be a large increasing displacement and people where you go. It seems inevitable to be onto the cities themselves. I understand. Already that's happening in a lot of areas. As we've happened, like Hong Kong Harbor, for example, they're solid. 1,000 people in communities living on the water, very primitive type systems, and then more current day evolving into living in the country, very comfortable with the water as well. But moving on to the water, this notion of biophilic design, where you see it on a very sort of mega scale, large scale cities, like in cities, and following sort of the biophilic design principles, like this, and so that kind of brings us to the fifth element, which is spirit, really the heart of the water. synergistic, generative mutual relationship And there's some extent the future is already now. There's been some places, like here in Singapore, for example, where you're seeing that biomimicry kind of taking it to its level. More good in Singapore is kind of leading the way in many ways to doing exactly that. The wealth and quality of those spaces and then, so this gentleman, by my view, is doing some of the most sort of visionary work that I'm familiar with currently. I don't know how much of this has been built yet, if any, or if it's still kind of in the beginning stage, but applying all the principles that I've talked about all along here, I think as much as anyone around the world is really kind of taking this to its limit. Certainly you see the fractal between imagery coming up here, biomimicry, not only stylistically, but also in terms of literally living buildings. So I think it's kind of still inspirational in terms of this kind of environment is something much more community, so the graveyard, doomsday, Mad Max, which is this is for myself, or what I hope to do with the function is in the depth of the world, so this is, you can see, this is something that I'm going to do. So hopefully this is our future, and as I said before,